challenged me to think through the issues, and he was just a spiritual hero to me. And one day he decided, in my college days, I never let my books get in the way of my education. I was in college to basically play football and all that kind of stuff. And he said, he knew God had called me to preach, and he wanted me to go to Talbot Seminary. He wanted me to study under Dr. Charles Feinberg. Chuck would know very well. And Charles Feinberg was one of a kind in the history of the world. There's no question about it.
Tell him what he used to do when he'd sit on the platform and you were preaching. Tell him about him at chapel. He'd sit there and, as you were preaching, remember?
Oh, yeah.
This is a great story
that's worth telling, okay? Feinberg decided, for the love of my father, that he was going to make a project out of me. When I got to seminary, he was going to try to make me useful to the kingdom. So he took me on as a personal project, and he invited me into his office almost on a weekly basis and gave me a book and told me to read it. Nothing to do with class. Nothing to do with class. I took every class he offered. The first class he taught was the book of Hebrews. I went in there in my first year. I'm taking Greek and Hebrew. I'm taking Hebrews from him. And first day in class, he says this. He says, are there any questions? Okay, we'll go on. And we had like 50 questions. The second day, he said, are there any questions? There was a brief pause. Some guy raised his hand. He said, what is it? The guy asked the question. He said, if you don't have any more intelligent questions than those, don't waste the class time. So that was the end of questions.
That was one of his better days.
That was a good day. That was a good day. To say he was a bit hard-nosed would be probably true. But he had a particular interest in me for my father's sake, and my grandfather was a very faithful pastor as well, and he had known them both, and so he wanted to make something out of me. Anyway, when it came my first time to preach in chapel, which is what Chuck's referring to, at Talbot Seminary, they would assign you a passage, and you had to preach before the student body with the faculty behind you. And the faculty sat spread out so that they were in full view of the students. Students could watch them. They had 8.5 by 14 criticism sheets that they filled out the whole time you're preaching. And this was their evaluation. This is not the ministry of encouragement by any stretch of imagination. And you know, you're trying to preach, and you know you hear these little pins going behind you, you know. he assigned me 2 Samuel 7. Which is the great promise of God through the dialogue between Nathan and David of the glorious kingdom of Messiah, the greater son than Solomon, blah, blah, blah. So I got this passage, and it was really a loaded choice by Feinberg. He was really testing the mettle of my theology. And so I worked on that thing about 30 hours. I really only cared what he thought. I mean, he was the guy. He was the man. And I just wanted to really show him I could do this. And I preached the sermon. Students seemed to like it. Went the way I planned it. And when you were done, you would go out the door at the end of chapel, and the faculty would hand you the sheets as you went out the door. And so about like 12 of them. He was at the end of the line, and he wouldn't look at me. He just had his head like this. And his sheet was folded up, and he did this. Just stuck it at me. And I knew this was not a good sign. So I went off in a corner and I unfolded it. And there were like all kinds of boxes and lines and things you had. You had, you know, numbers 1 through 6 on gestures and all kinds of stuff. He had nothing. All he had written in red was, you missed the entire point of the passage.
Oh, wow.
That is a challenge to do, you know, to work about 25 hours and miss the whole point of the passage. I mean, that's pretty clever, if nothing else. I was absolutely rocked. I was devastated. I gave a message on not presuming on God, because Nathan presumed on God and told, you know, David to go build a house. He wanted a message on on dispensational issues dealing with the coming of the Davidic kingdom and all this stuff. Anyway, he called me to his office, and I walked in his office, and he was just mad. He was ticked, because that was one of his pet passages. I didn't know that at the time. So I was now in a position where I had sunk so low, he knew the difficulty of the project ahead of him in trying to make me into something useful. It was the greatest lesson I ever learned in seminary. And I think for all the years of my life, he sits on my shoulder and says, "Don't miss the point of the passage. You have no right to put words in God's mouth and say he said what he didn't say, nor do you have a right to take words out of his mouth and not say what he did say. You have to get it right."
Tell him what he gave you. Tell him what he gave you. I love this reward. I can tell this story better than John, but I want John to tell this story. Tell it all, John. It's a great story.
So he continued. My best buddy in seminary was Paul Feinberg, his son, who's now with the Lord. And we struck up a friendship. And you never really had a friendship with Dr. Feinberg, but at least I never did. But anyway, he would call me in and give me books, and he would monitor me. And finally, when I graduated from seminary, he called me into his office. And he had a full set of Kylan Dalich. Kylan Dalich is a classic Hebrew Old Testament commentary of about 20 volumes. It's like this. And he said to me, "I have a gift for you." And in two boxes, he had put his personal Kylan Dalich set. And he's a Hebrew scholar, studied 14 years to be a rabbi, was converted, could read the whole Old Testament in Hebrew, quote passages in Hebrew. So this was his thing. And he'd written all his notes in the margins and all the stuff that he had for years of studying Kylan Dalich. And his gift to me was his own set, with all his notes in the margins. And he said, "Now you have no excuse."
That's a great story. That's good.
Now, Chuck doesn't know the end of the story. Jack, only once in my life did I ever minister with him, and it was at a prophets conference at the First Baptist Church of Dallas. You remember those? School of the Prophets? And Criswell was there, and he invited us to come, and it was my first experience to sit on the platform, you know, with all the falderal about where you have to put your feet and how you have to put your face on the ground when you pray and all that.
Make sure you bring your offering envelope, right, and turn that in.
Yeah, but that was the time we ministered together in that conference, and over the years, he basically got Alzheimer's or something, and at the end, he didn't even know he was a Christian anymore. He thought he was an unconverted Jew. And he was in a home, and all he ever did that connected with the past was call faculty meetings of the people. Yeah. But when it came to his funeral, the family asked me if I would speak. And so somewhere along the line, he must have told them, "I think MacArthur has figured out how to get the meaning of the passage." So that was like my final vindication to talk at his funeral.
That's a great story.
And I need to say this, lest it be out of balance. I personally adored the man.
Yeah.
I just loved him. I love him to this very day. I see his name on a book on Ezekiel or Minor Prophets, and my heart just